2011. Sister Catherine, please.
Why do you keep doing it? Picture.
Lord, our God, as we gather here tonight, we come before you asking for blessings and abundance. We pray especially that you direct all the deliberations that take place, that you help us to truly be wise, to truly be prudent, to remember that we have been chosen as your servants to serve the people who have called us to this place. Let our deliberations be for their good, not for our glory. We also ask that our decisions be made with the light of your wisdom. As your people gathered here, we come especially tonight praying for coolness and moisture, that as you give us your bounty and wisdom, that you also give us your goodness and grace that we need and the fullness that we hope for. All of these prayers to them we say, amen.
Amen.
Is there any additions to the agenda this evening?
I'd like to have a 10-minute executive session up there where you put the deal. I'd like to push it out.
Okay. New business?
That'd be fine. We thought we got a whole house for us.
10 minutes.
To approve the minutes of the regular meeting, June 21st, 2011. Approve the minutes for special meeting, July 12th, 2011. Sorry, that's a typo. Approve appropriation ordinance 0705-2011 in the amount of $77,094.78. And approve appropriation ordinance 0719-2011 in the amount of $55,790.63.
Some comments. Donna, say your last name for me.
Meyer Pfeiffer.
Pfeiffer, okay.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to be here. I do apologize how I'm dressed tonight. I just quickly came from a CPR class. I normally don't wear shorts when I do the presentation, but thank you for being here. As I said, my name is Donna Meyer Pfeiffer. I'm the executive director of the Cannonball Trail chapter. We do cover six counties. That's Barber, Comanche, Edwards, Kiowa, Pratt, and Stafford. Ben, I'll be celebrating my 10th anniversary on September 10th, so we'll always remember that date of September 10th, 2001. What I'm here is just kind of give you an update of what the American Red Cross has done. Since I've been here, we have had what we consider four level threes, that disasters that we covered that cost the chapter over $50,000 plus dollars. And then, of course, May 4th of 2007, which covered Pratt and Stafford and Edwards and Cuyahoga counties. So that was over $1 million that cost our chapter. We're here to stay. We do a lot of CPR training, which I would like to come down into Stafford County and do more of that because, unfortunately, we are not getting younger and health issues are a major concern to us. In fact, I just did 3 CPR classes today. And beyond that, we're doing disaster training classes. We need, we are here in rural America. We need to be trained to respond. I work closely with Mr. Steve Moody. We've been on several of the grass fires that he's had, delivering water, and one time we even brought meals. Single family fires, we attend to those to make sure that people do have a roof over their head. Not everybody has insurance or families that they can go to. And that's part of the humanitarian mission of the American Red Cross. We're a small chapter, but we do a lot of things, and there's a lot more things that we can do if we can get the support of the communities. And I'm here asking for financial support. I know that money is very tight, and that's why I'm going to all of them and ask, and I'm kind of basing it on per capita of the community, is if you would please consider a budgeting $1,000 a year into your budget to support our chapter. I'm going not just all to the cities, as well as I'm going to the counties to ask for some financial support. That way we can work up a budget, I know what we have, and then I can go out and, you know, what needs to meet our budget. I'm the only paid employee at the chapter, so everything that I do there is myself or get volunteers to assist to perform. We do have a very strong, what I call a DAT team, disaster action team, made up of volunteers basically from Barber, Edwards, and Cuyahoga counties right now. And those are people that are trained that can take the leadership when we're called out. So we like to train a lot more of that and get that instilled. A co-ed organization, which is called Communities Organizations Active in Disaster, to be trained in a lot of different areas, not just Red Cross training, but also on the emergency managers to fill the void where there is, because we have another EF5 or an EF4 or even an EF3. We all know in rural America we've got to pull together and work. When people are trained, you can expedite that service so much better. Spontaneous volunteers are absolutely wonderful, but when you first got to get onto the site, it's important that people know where to go with that. So I'm working with all the emergency directors in all the counties, plus outside of the counties. I'm a member of the Kansas Emergency Managers Association, so I stay very focused with the state also. So I'd love to entertain, I know that's a lot in a very short period of time, but I'd love to entertain any questions that you may have. Or I can spend a half hour on my soapbox. Vicki, come up with a question. Vicki used to do our financials, so I know her very well. Well, if there's no questions, I appreciate you giving me time. I see that you have a full house, so I won't take up any more of your time, but I do hope that you will consider my request.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Donna. Fire Department, Michael?
The only thing I have is we're not going to allow any burning in the city limits until we get some rain.
Thank you.
That's it.
Appreciate that. Is there any questions for Michael this evening? Thank you, Michael. Appreciate it. Police Department. Sonny, do you have anything this evening?
I don't have anything except for we would like to get the new chief sworn in from our platoon.
Okay. Matt, what do you do?
Chief of Police.
So help me God. Thank you very much. Sunny for Matt this evening.
Oh, but welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you, Sunny. Administration, Donna.
Vicki Dratton's here with Adam's grandmother as well, to go get a pot of report that was in her pocket. I'm going to go ahead and present the audit report. If you have any questions at any time during my whole presentation, feel free to ask me. Stop me at any time. I'd like you to go to page one of the bound report. That is actually our auditor's opinion on the financial statements. Those five paragraphs can be summed up in saying that we are issuing an unqualified opinion on the financial statements, which is the highest form of an opinion we can issue on a set of financial statements. The last paragraph in there says, the financial statements referred to above present fairly, in all material respects, the cash and unencumbered cash balances of the City of St. John, their respective cash receipts, disbursements, and budgetary results for the year that ended. Your financial statements are presented on a statutory basis, which the City passes a resolution every year to allow that form of presentation. That is different than generally accepted accounting principles. Basically, you're on a cash basis with the exception of your payables, your expenditures. You do accrue your year-end payables into your expenditures. And then also the city does encumbrances. That also at year-end will be taken into account and add those as expenditures for the year so that they can be applied to the current year budget. On page two, is a summary of all of your funds. It shows your beginning unencumbered cash balances, your prior year canceled encumbrances. What that represents is if you had an encumbrance, say like for $10,000 for the general fund, and you only spent $9,000 of that encumbrance, the other $1,000 is what we call canceled encumbrances. It gets added back into the unencumbered cash balance of that fund. You could re-encumber those funds, but then that re-encumbrance becomes an expenditure in the year that you encumber it. So we had about 16,000 of those prior year canceled encumbrances. Under cash receipts, we have total cash receipts, expenditures, and then our ending unencumbered cash balance. And again, the unencumbered cash balance is different than your normal cash. Your cash is your reconciled cash at year end, less any outstanding encumbrances or accounts payable. You've had about $194,000 in outstanding accounts payable and or encumbrances. Most of that is encumbrances, but the city has said we are going to put those funds aside for expenditures that we haven't paid for yet because we want them to come out of the 2010 budget. We ended the year with $1,535,832 in unencumbered cash. Basically, that is up about $288,000 over the prior year. I think the city did a great job of putting some funds away in several of their reserve accounts. And anytime you can build up some excess cash like that for down the road expansion, property, equipment, those types of things, that's good. On page three, we call this our summary of expenditures, actual and budget. This statement shows all of your funds that are required to be budgeted. It shows your actual certified budget that you approve and get submitted to the county and the state. And then it shows your expenditures that you charge to that year per fund. The very far right-hand column shows if you have a variance over or under. All of your variances were under, which meant that you stayed within your budget limitations for those funds, which is also very good. Okay. Over the next several pages, it just goes into a little more detail over your individual funds, shows your cash receipts in a little more detail and your cash expenditures. I'm not going to spend much time on there unless you have some specific questions over those. I'd like you to go to the footnotes, which start on page 29. And there are a couple of footnotes that I'd like to point out to you. The footnotes just give some more information about the financial statements, the policies, procedures of the city,
self-explanatory. On page 35, along with the financial statements, we are required to look at various statutes. And if the city is in violation of the statute, we have to note it in the footnotes. And we have one violation. A payroll check was outstanding for more than 1 year, and that's a violation of KSA 583935. If it's over 1 year, you're supposed to turn it over to the state as unclaimed property. Probably every avenue should be explored in trying to get that check cashed by that individual, so you don't have to do that. Either maybe even reissuing the check and doing that before you have to take it over to unclaimed property. But that's just one of the, that was the only statute violation that we have.
And that has to be.
On page 37 and 38, we have what's called a long-term debt schedule. This lists all the outstanding debt of the city. The city has now just two general obligation bonds that they're paying on, and then they've got four capital leases. For the year, at the year end, we had about $167,846 of outstanding debt. And we paid about $9,890 in interest for the year. We also have what we call compensated absences, and this would be any accrued vacation, sick, or other comp time that was unpaid but earned by your employees at year end. And that totaled $149,000. The next page, page 38, kind of goes in and gives you a calendar in 5-year increments of what your principal and interest payments are going to be over those years for your both your general obligation bonds and your capital leases. So as you can see in 2011, total principal and interest payments would be about $53,000. Does anybody have any questions on the financial statements or any of the information I went over? In addition to the financial statements, we also look at the internal controls of the city, and we offer recommendations each year on things that we feel that could be improved upon. And then we're also required to assess 115 letter, and it starts. It's one of the staple letters. It starts in planning and performing our audit. There's two items that we have to note as significant deficiencies. And I'd say probably 95% of the audits we have to note these on. One deals with segregation of duties because of the size of the city's accounting personnel. We don't have adequate segregation of duties where we can't fully separate all the duties to make sure we have adequate internal So we cite that. There's really nothing the city can do about it. It'd be cost prohibitive to hire somebody just so you could get that out of your. That's where the council becomes involved, and that's why we want the extra control coming from the council to review expenditures, looking over their financials, that type of thing. The other item was fairly new. It came about last year. It was a new standard, and it's called SAS 115. It also, we have to cite it because the city does not employ somebody that could adequately prepare the financial statements. Pretty much the numbers are right on track, and she could probably put them in the financial statement format. However, the footnotes would probably be the thing that most of our cities would have problems coming up with the required footnote information that's in the financial statement. So we have to note that as well. The second letter is what we call our management letter, or our letter of charge to those with governance. And basically in here, then, we put our other matters that we just want to mention might be other internal control items that we feel the city could improve upon. On the second page, kind of halfway down the middle, it starts with property and equipment. I think we've kind of had this in the management letter in the past. We just felt that it'd be a good idea to get some type of software or something to track unnecessary costs of the equipment, find out, you know, as far as, I mean, they're taking inventory and things like that, but if something would happen to the city, we would be able to maintain, have this list available for insurance purposes, that type of thing. So also it's a fraud protection type. So if you have a good listing of all your items that you have and own, it's a safeguarding of your assets. The second one was inventory. Again, we know that this is probably hard to do. The city shop's not locked during the day. In small towns, it's really not usually a problem, but you never know when some people from outside your towns come in, wander around, and they find an open door that they can help themselves to. So, again, we put that note in there. Under safeguarding computer systems and files, we recommend that the computer system backups be taken off site at least a week, once a week, and periodically checked throughout the year. Again, that's if the software goes down, that you have a good backup, or if something happens to the building, that you have an avenue to get those files and you'll be up and running again. And obviously, we want to make sure that those files are in working order. And then also, we recommend limiting the user access to only computer accounting modules necessary for a job function. Most of the girls can get in any of the accounting software, and we'd like to see that limited. I think Donna and Vicki pretty much need access to everything, but I think Donna could have access just to the utility building.
We have.
And you have to, and you take care of that. Just a basically a fraud risk management program, again, going through not only what we do as far as internal controls, but seeing if there's areas within your organization that you think have greater risks of fraud and maybe dealing with those and seeing what you can do to prevent or heighten your controls in those areas. The vacation, when we were here this year, it looked like there might have been a misunderstanding on how the vacation leave policy was being handled versus what's in the manual. And we just said, you know, just change what's in the manual to match your current practice. I think there was some confusing word terminology in there. Under general matters, when approving a purchase or a bid, the council minutes should reflect the approved vendor name as well as the amount. And then again, we listed the statute violation of the unpaid payroll check. All in all, I would have to say that when we left, we told Jonna we felt like the city of St. John was one of our model audit clients. We didn't have any adjusting entries to make, and we only had three reclassifying entries to make. And that's pretty much unheard of for the audits that we do. So they do a very good job of being meticulous about making sure they're coding their items correctly and making sure their financials are accurate. So we applaud them for their effort on that. It's a good job.
Need a motion to approve?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
approve the budget and set the budget hearing date. The changes that you asked to have made after the budget workshop has been worked in. When we reduced the general fund, I needed to rework the neighborhood revitalization. So the numbers are a little bit different and a little bit lower, but everything is reflected in what I sent to you in your packets.
Stupid question. How come 14 wouldn't be a zero now?
What page are you looking at?
1-2. You know, before we worried about 11-110, and that's what we wiped out, and then we still got 11-99 on there.
This is, we don't control anything on this page. This is a page that I've input from figures from everybody else. The county treasurer, the county clerk, things that have come from the years before. So nothing on this page, on page 2, do we have any control over? The debt service levy?
That was what he was talking about.
We didn't change anything in the debt service. That's just our bonds. Okay. As far, debt service would be things that we have borrowed money on. So we just changed the general fund. And this actually is picked up off of the debt service page in the worksheet, so we don't input that there. It's very good. But if you go to the debt service page, because of timing, then that's still appropriate, but I need to check the calendar. If we want to set the date 10 days after Wednesday,
July the 27th, paper come out.
And so we have 10 days after that.
August 5th would be 10 days after, right?
So that week.
Between the 8th and 12th.
So if you want to keep your regular Tuesday nights, it would be the 9th. I will say in the past, it's been a matter of opening for the hearing and closing. Right. But it could be that somebody might have questions.
We can't wait till the 16th. When does the county need it?
I think they have to be submitted on the 15th.
Wait, what?
What?
I think they have to be submitted to the county on the 15th.
25th of August, which means after the hearing, though, I think there's 10 days waiting before we can submit it.
I would suggest move mine.
And we just need a quorum. We don't need to have full council if full council can make it.
So August the 9th, will that work?
I can make it.
Stick with 7? Or is that what we're planning?
Yes, please.
No, the 5 days should not be by this.
Anything.
Anything over the 5 days?
Yeah, access them.
Just say wait for what it is.
Well, the auditors don't want it that way. I mean, they don't, we need to make the policy change, the wording in the policy, so that it matches what we actually do. And that's what this is doing.
So, you've been doing it wrong?
For 25 years or whatever?
Yeah.
So they're asking us to correct that?
Or make them follow the current.
There hasn't been any problems with the way the employees use their vacation days, so I don't know why we...
No, but you want to word it correctly, Kevin, so they understand what we're
He's
doing.
Saying we should do what it says here.
Yeah, no more than 5 days.
Change what we do instead of the words.
Plus 5 days.
Without approval.
Without approval.
That gives them a total of 10.
That's right.
No. It doesn't give, it's just 5 days of previous year. If there's more than 5 days, say if somebody didn't get to use their 5 days from the previous, or say last year, I didn't use all my vacation days. I didn't come and ask to have it carried over. I had more than five that I didn't use. I didn't come in and ask. I could have, but I just carried the 5 over.
Yeah, that's the way it reads. They have to have approval.
Yes. But more than we have a motion on the table.
Yes.
We have a motion
Second.
On the table. Is there any more discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no. Questions for Donna this evening?
No, but I would like to state that was an excellent report.
Thank you.
So you should feel very good about that.
The girls work very hard. And me as well.
And you.
Yeah.
We work together.
It's a team. Yes. Thank you, John. Legal. Don?
I would request every 30-minute executive session for trade secrets. I'd like to include Mayor, Council, Mel, John, Carolyn Dunn, Greg Wright, and myself.
Was this to bring in the...
their consultants.
Yes. Okay, so I'll answer that.
Okay, can you list that again, please? Make sure it is with somebody.
List them again.
For Mayor, Council, Mel, John, Carolyn Dunn, Greg Wright, myself.
Thank you, Greg.
Okay, administration, Mel is out, so I think we can go ahead and probably...
Greg, yeah, Greg is going to...
Do you want to come up, Greg?
Yeah. Just a little discussion on the concept of the wind. If you recall, those that were here at the time we talked about the wind turbine at the school district was a possibility, and we presented the a rate schedule that had a demand and energy that would allow them to put it in there in a wind generator that would net out the energy only and would have a demand charge to cover our fixed cost. And we kind of agreed that concept would work, but we didn't want to necessarily let any reason to have any action on it unless somebody actually would want to put it in there now. Recently, you've had somebody request a residential to put a wind turbine in, and needs to kind of see what the tariff would be. So we need to, if we're still ready to do that, not tonight, because I was going to pass out the actual draft language for the ordinance that you need to pass within next meeting. You'll have a chance to look it over from now on and just hopefully vote on it. This is the mission we talk about. What you've already got. You've already passed the interconnect agreement we talked about, which specifies how they do it, and that's what the school district has completed the application to interconnect with your system with the generator. You've already got that in place, so we don't need to do that. What we would do is we would pass an ordinance, again, not tonight, but we just pass it along. Supplemental generation such as wind turbines or diesel generators and shall be billed as under the following rate. You have an energy charge, a fuel adjustment, which you've got now, and then a peak demand component, which would be on the basis of the peak demand set in any given month, the highest 15-minute peak. And then this next paragraph is one that I wanted to discuss that we didn't talk about last time was that you would basically agree to net out all energy, and then at the end of the month, if they generated more than they took, so like for instance, if they used 10,000 kilowatt hours in a month, or 10,000 for sake of discussion, and they generated 11,000, they basically have zero energy that you would provide them to, and they actually provided to you 1,000. Kilowatt hours, for example. And then you would pay them back at a cost of 1.5% of your monthly average energy only price. And the reason you do that is because we're not going to go hour to hour. So some of that times they're providing energy back to you at higher value times, other times slower times. So this way it averages out, allows them to net it out. But because we're putting demand and energy into that scenario, if you didn't have the demand and energy, you would have a zero bill basically to the customer. Here, you still have a demand charge because they don't want to be blown all the time, so you still recover what your fixed cost, and they would just basically get out the energy only. Now, if they generated 10,000 and bought 10,000, then there would be no payment by the city to them, because you would basically have it out. Most likely, the scenario would be you would provide 10,000 and they generated 1,000, and so you'd bill them for 9,000 under this rate. This is the normal way. But there will be some months Now, there's the other way you could do it, some other people do it hour to hour, and so every hour they look at what they're actually generating on the bill. So this would be the rate.
So when you say some people do that.
Yeah, other some utilities would do an hour to hour profile.
And so the meters are red then, or
okay. It's a recording meter. Now you hear this in this scenario you wouldn't need it. So your billing would consist of just two. You get demand rate, energy rate, and then a production rate. You take your what you provided to them minus what they provided, what they generated, and then be billed for the difference. And the only time there would be any payment back would be that they provided more to you than you did to them.
How did we come up with the 0.55?
Well, that was based on the energy. What we did was we looked at your current cost. Yeah. And now the we had to reprint this thing, and the color didn't show, but that's just the energy and demand. Basically, that was the based on the average wholesale price that you're doing at this particular time. So we set that here. If you look, this was where we ran this scenario on the 10.55. Now is energy only, and then the 2.8 cents ECA. And then what I did, I went in there and took a demand and energy charge based on your system load factor. So basically, at the same system load factor, you drive the same cost, average cost per kilowatt between demand and energy. If you have a higher load factor, you're buying energy at a higher load than the city's load profile. So that's what that number comes in now. The 5.5 is the base energy plus the fuel adjustment. So if your wholesale cost can be higher, there's still a fuel adjustment associated with it. It's the same as what you're doing now. So what that does is allows you to somebody to install for alternative generation, and but not just net actual cost. I mean, if you put in there that they would just generate, if you didn't have the minimum energy rate, then they would be basically saving. Somebody to generate would be displacing 10.5 cents kilowatt hours. That's what your energy rate is, and you know the wires are still there, everything's still there, and all they're doing is displacing your wholesale cost, which is a 5.5 is the term. That's what they're about to discuss.
Is that common for most, I mean, other people or other cities that have this?
Yeah, well, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, the same percentages or what?
No, different cities have different cost structures, but essentially there's kind of all over the map, if you will. Some cities are saying we'll net out kilowatt for kilowatt hour, but cap the amount that can be on there. You know, say can't have more than 3% of the total, or other cities are saying allowing some fixed amount of whatever the wholesale cost is displaced. It just all depends on what it is. These numbers are relevant to you, not necessarily somebody else, but they're fairly close.
I'm just curious what other cities do, or not necessarily what our cost is, but what other cities do, or other companies, however you want to.
They're doing it both ways, but essentially right now it's a fairly new concept. That's why we rolled it out a while back, is went ahead and approved the interconnect, because that way you have some sort of a provision that makes people comply with the code and what have you. But the Kansas Municipal Utilities has recommended that all cities move forward at some point in some sort of their own policy or procedure to have this in place. No cities right now are mandated to, but wholesale, investor-owned utilities are being mandated to have a certain amount of wind or renewable energy in their portfolio. You guys aren't. So there hasn't been any real strong movement to do that at this particular time. So people are basically like you, waiting until they have somebody that's interested in doing the development policy. So there's not that many out there right now. The last I heard, there was four or five cities that have adopted a meeting type procedure.
Any other slides, Greg?
Greensburg. Greensburg is a little different. The one you hear about was a wind farm, and there are some that have done that. As quite honestly, you guys have had a chance to. Midwest Energy has requested some information on that. We can partner on wind farms and buy in from the city. This is an individual customer on the other side. Greensburg has allowed, because of the nature that they have a wind farm that everybody hears about, like 10 megawatts, but they also have some internal structures or internal generation in there. And I'm not really sure how they're doing it, other than I think they're just doing straight emitting. But are they? Do you know, Carolyn? No.
They are. I mean, if they don't have any special tariff, they get full retail rate for each kilowatt they generate.
Yeah, so in this case,
it's part of, I think, their positioning of their city.
We talked about that. The city, we wanted to be able to allow them to have it and net out some portion of the energy that they do, to basically let them save what you guys save, but not subsidize it. That was the thing was with the school district. That was the issue, that if you just did a pure netting of your straight energy costs, you're basically, everybody else is subsidizing that installation, and that really wasn't fair. So this is trying to say, whatever we're saving, we'll allow the consumer to save as well.
The city still has your distribution costs, your overhead of your people, your line charges. I mean, so you have to have some return on that investment in order to maintain those services. So that's the reason for the demand charge. That captures that component of it. You're offsetting the energy charge, which will fluctuate with whatever the price of energy is. So they're being allowed to sell back to the city the energy portion, but the city is still allowed to recapture some of their costs that they have in the distribution charges, the lines, the people maintain the lines, the overhead of the power plant, that kind of thing.
Well, and we have a contract too that we have to purchase so much, right?
No, right.
So whether, you know, if they're not using above what we purchase, we still have to purchase that whether they're using it or not.
Right. But, you know, so the demand charts cover some of that. If somebody were to generate all month and not be off the system all the time, then they're completely off, you know, at that point. But that's not really a winter type thing. That'd be a peak and generate some sort of a diesel generator or something that would occur. And then they're completely shaving their people the whole time, but they generate that at a fairly high cost. But this would work for that as well. So if somebody did, then they would avoid the demand charge. So basically, what I'm going to do for the next time is submit that with this language, the tariff, with the language, called the net metering agreement that was put together and I provided several meetings ago from Kansas Utility drafted it up and presented it to everybody and recommended that all cities move forward with one at some point in time. Kind of sitting there and saying, whenever the time is right, go ahead and approve it. So there's already kind of pre-agreed language, if you will, for the municipal up there, and that's going to put down with them. That, with our own language for the ordinance, is what we would be recommending.
I would like to see what some of the other cities are doing for their rate, though.
Okay.
Instead of just
agreeing to this
level.
Right. Okay. See what.
I would like to see what other options there are, okay, rather than just rolling with this thing.
Okay.
see those at the next council meeting, Troy, or do you want Greg just to give the information to the mail and hand it out to you, or?
I'd say we can just do it at the next meeting.
And then the language too, we'll get that to you ahead of time, so you can see the language.
That time, if we, whatever rate we can decide at that point, we'll put it in there, correct?
Yep.
Okay.
That's all it'll take, and then you're ready to go.
But any other questions for Greg? Thanks, Greg. Okay, the water well work update. Okay.
At the special meeting, the council approved some additional drilling. So we were able to get that completed.
Mm-hmm. Is that the same thing as
that? No, oh. This is different.
Okay, so just a minute. Bring those back. Not yet. And has what?
We're going to talk about those if you want to have them.
Go ahead, Andrew. Yeah, okay. Okay. All right. Sorry, guys. I didn't want to get confused on that.
We added the deep observation well.
Is this the one over there? No, sorry.
And collected samples from nearby, mostly lawn and garden wells. That's the lab results that you're seeing. And what we found with the deep bathymeter observation well, bedrock, we encountered bedrock at 115 feet. That was basically, this is the positioning of the three wells. This was the first well that was drilled at 85 feet, and it's 15 foot of stream. And with gravity from very near the stream up to land surface. The shallow well is to the northeast, and that is screened from 35 to 45 feet. So we're taking the water out of the very top part of the aquifer. And then we put the deep observation well in the bedrock, and that is screened from 100 to 115. And one of the things we were concerned with was chlorides, and we did find some additional chlorides there, but they're still well within acceptable limits. They were 140 on chlorides. The important thing is nitrates 1.3. That's the important thing.
And
chloride. Salt, sodium chloride, it's naturally occurring. Some of it's from oil field contamination, but we have a lot of naturally occurring salt water in this area. And part of it is from the Permian system, the Cedar Hill sandstone is a subcrop to the freshwater aquifer. It starts about 281 highway, and that discharges salt water naturally out of the Cedar Hill sandstone. And that salt water will run, it'll run 40 to 50,000 on chlorides and 45,000 on sulfates. So really not usable at all. And that's one of the sources of the salt that a lot of the irrigation systems deal with from here east and southeast is out of the Permian system. And then some of it's oil field related. It's all going to test out the same for the most part. It's going to look like Permian salt because they drilled through the salt section. And that was put out on land surface and has now worked its way back through. And then there's some old, some of the old sins on the oil patch, a lot of mold and hydride test holes. Plugged one southwest of St. John several years ago. The leak forever and ever and ever. They're out there. But we're still well within acceptable limits on the chlorides. Typically 250 is what we look at for cutoff on that. And that's an aesthetic value, primarily because as the chlorides increase, the sodium level increases. And they have a recommended level of 100 milligrams per liter on sodium. And we're at 81 with that zone. But for chlorides, they recommend 250. That's because of the tie with the sodium and the sodium chloride, the primary salt.
What said this? We were 81. Said we were 25.
25. Sulfates. Sulfates is another component out of the Permian system, and we're real good on that. That's 250 is the limit on sulfates as well. If you get much over 250, then we start seeing laxative effects.
Do we have them actual test results?
Yes. You got test hole 1 and 2 the last go around. Test hole 3-11 is on the front page here. It's that one right there.
Okay.
It's the front page?
Yeah. Yes. Some of the outlying domestic wells, long guard wells we sampled, we have a couple of them that are over the limit of 10. Three of them were under, which was encouraging. The reason that's encouraging is we discussed at the last meeting, but we weren't real sure where these high nitrates were coming from in the shallow aquifer. I wasn't sure if that was what was coming off of town or if it was coming off of the field. And it appears at this time it's coming off the field. It's residual fertilizer, based on what we're seeing right now. Based on the available records, a lot of the lawn and garden wells in town are very shallow. And they're in the 50 to 60 foot range. So they're pulling out of that upper zone, which is a good deal. I mean, they're utilizing that water and recirculating those nitrates. Unfortunately, I'm sure some of them are adding to that, which is not uncommon. That's the way that things operate.
Does Leisure Homestead have a sprinkler system?
Yes.
And so does Schultz's?
Yes.
Looks like there might be a little something common there. 16.5 on one, 11 on the 8 on the other.
I would guess the common is fertilizer. Would be my guess, Bob. That's.
But the water intense is already putting nitrogen on the ground.
And we're, with this information, based on that formula that we got from the survey, survey publication, you know, they can back off of what they're applying because of what they're getting out of the water. We looked at, just based on the numbers from the shallow observation well, 18 inches of water per acre, that would, based on the KGS formula, you're looking at almost 100 pounds of available land. So that's 16, he's looking at 75 pounds of available in if he puts on 18 inches of water a year.
Does Todd Roberts have a watering system?
No.
They're using hoses and sprinklers right now. Smith's is strictly livestock. I don't know that they're doing much outside irrigation. If there's, that one was under 10.
To me, like we need to shut the nitrogen off the yards. I'm looking at this deal.
I think that's where the education process kicks in. With, especially if the city chooses to go with the Soil Smart Protection Program, that will be a component of that process. And I think that the vast majority of the people, once they understand what's going on, they'll make the right decision. They're not going down there to spend that money on fertilizer because they just got an extra to spend. They think they're doing the right thing. And
so
this is something they don't know about.
So explain that. You're going to limit or...
I'm not going to.
Explain to these people that they're contributing to this, that maybe they'll cut back on what they do.
If they realize they're getting plenty of it in their water that's already seeped through.
Okay, I didn't even get a chance to ask my question. So I guess my question is, is there a stipulation then that would not allow them to fertilize? Is that what you're saying?
That can be done.
Up to the city.
That would be up to the city to do that.
So people put in or have their yards and their sprinkler systems, and then as a city, we would consider doing that? I'm asking council.
To say it's not a question for Ned. I don't know where you were looking. I'm sorry.
I think there's a whole great big can of worms that you don't need to worry about right now.
Start with the education process.
Yeah.
And what is that? What is
Well, you get that information out to those people. You get them out to the well owners. One of the things we look at is well construction. You weren't here at the last meeting, and I understand that. But one of the important things of how these nitrates get into the groundwater is either over application, direct entry pathways. Nitrates, unfortunately, are not like most ag chemicals. Most ag chemicals will tie to the soil profile, they'll tie to organic matter, they'll tie to the clay particles in the soil profile, and they don't mobilize. Nitrates do not do that. They are very mobile. So we have the natural fractures in the soil profile. We have what we call macro and micro pores, which is a plant root holes, worm holes, annular spaces on bore holes, on wells. We have a lot of wells in the city that have very minimal grout. They have what is required by rules and regs, but that doesn't necessarily get the job done. So what we see with what we did here is, had we not grouted these wells deep enough, as deep as we have, we could pump them to the point that we will draw the nitrate down the borehole into that deeper zone or into the intermediate zone. We will drag that nitrate from up above down there deep. And the reason that happens is these sands and gravels that we're drilling in were laid down horizontally as they were deposited. So water naturally flows through them better horizontally than they do vertically until we poke a hole through. And once we do that, then and that intersects that borehole, then the pathway becomes up and down in annular space. There's some of them, or if they have a long screen in, then that really accelerates that. To give you an idea of how little screened interval it takes, these are 2-inch diameter wells. We had 15 feet of screen on those, and we were able to airlift 30 to 36 gallons a minute out of those wells. So with a large capacity well, 5-inch casing, 5-foot screen would make every bit of water that they would need for long work well in town for gross problem. It's an incredible amount of water that you can get out of this aquifer with that kind of well. Where the city goes with restrictions would be up to the city, and that would be as tough or as lenient as you want to make it. That would be part of your source water protection plan if you go to that route.
Okay. Wondering, I'm getting ready to build a house. I have 2 acres that we were going to put back to grass. And you know, that's a concern.
Grass is a great user of fertilizer. I mean, it takes a lot of, it takes a lot.
It does.
But what we typically see is our urban farmers, if you will, apply sometimes as much as 4 to 6 times as what we would do on agriculture rates. So,
I just kind of needed to know where we're going with this.
There are places in Nebraska, they don't do it at the cities, they do it at the agricultural level. You don't buy fertilizer in the fall until you provide a water sample and a soil sample, and then do a nutrient management plan, and then based on that, then the agronomist determines how much fertilizer they can buy for the year. And the reason for that is there were wells up there at one time that were putting on 250 pounds of available land just out of the ground. It looks pretty good for them.
You could start by not having the city buy any more fertilizer.
Well, it has nothing to do with the city itself. It's homeowners themselves, Kevin.
Yeah, but we would start a trend.
Well, it's not saying don't do any. It's just saying don't do as much.
Because ground will normally you take up a certain amount of fertilizer, you know, and that's why farmers run soil samples, so they know, okay, this is what it needs and this is what it will use. Farmers can't afford to put on twice as much as they need, but a homeowner, if it costs them, they put on twice as much, it doesn't cost them enough, they don't worry about it.
They're not doing it on purpose.
Yeah.
Right. You know, I mean, that's the important thing, is they're not doing it on purpose. They don't know what the process is. And the bag says, the bag says, I need to put this amount of pounds on this square footage. So,
how many gallons per minute that will come in the depot?
We just airlifted that one at 30.
30.
Where we go from here, we're back to the point where we, what I discussed with Mel and Don briefly is, we're to the point now, if you're still wanting to pursue a well at that location, we would install a 5-inch test well, and I'd crowd that shallow observation well as tight as I could get to it, so that I can see how much effect the pumping has on that shallow zone, whether we're moving water out of that shallow zone. And then I would also recommend that we add an additional observation well about 200 feet northwest, so that we can look at how large an area. We'll have the close-in observation wells, but we can also look at distance to see how much effect we have off of the test well. I'd recommend we run at least a three-step test. What that does is once the well is installed and developed, then we would start at about 30-35 gallons a minute, run that for an hour, and we would add increase the flow to 65 gallons a minute, and run that for an hour, and then we would increase the flow, basically the full open flow, which would be a well at this location, 5 horsepower pump should do 100 to 110 gallons a minute. And then once we get that information, we would be monitoring the existing observation wells that are there to see what impact we have. And then we would typically allow everything to recover and would run a long-term aquifer test. And because of the dynamics of this system and what the city's trying to do, that should be a 24-hour test. And with that, then we would pull samples through that testing period from the well. Now, we don't need to run everything. We'd be probably just looking at chlorides and nitrates to see if those do change, because we've got a pretty good handle on the rest of the water quality. But as far as times, that would be what we call a time series analysis, and we would see then what changes, if any, there are with time during that pumping period. And we will be able to look at the water level changes in the observation wells as well to help determine what effects we have on those upper zones. Again, the goal is to if we look at putting in production wells, is to take that water off the bottom of the aquifer and not exceed, not with excessive pumping rates, or we will drag that down eventually. That will happen. I'm very confident of that. One of the reasons we don't see the high nitrates in that deeper zone is they just simply didn't go that deep. A lot of these wells, they went in 40, 50 feet, got all the water they needed, and they quit. Some of the deeper wells you'll see, it's, well, they have a minimum, so we just have to do the minimum. Whether they need it 50 feet or 80, they just have to do the minimum.
Okay.
And Dawn, I'll let
Dawn
have his.
Okay.
Thanks, Nick.
Sure.
You need a motion to approve additional drilling?
Council wants to do that, but I think they need to hear from y'all.
Yeah, let me talk to you first.
Yeah.
I agree 100% with what Ned has told you, but there's some things that you need to think about first. Okay, one is, I mean, last time I was here, we talked about the reason we looked over here was so we didn't have to cross under the railroad tracks down that south well. Okay, and I told you if we put a well up here, without this cost is going about equal out. And that's true if you put one well in up here. And Ned's talking about putting in three or four smaller wells, and that's a different ballgame. Okay, now, you know, if you put in four wells, you could be talking $250,000, $300,000 more at this location than at South location, because you got putting in four wells instead of one, and you got all the extra piping to bring in. So that's just something to think about. Now, the other thing that I've looked into is because these wells are so low, is we have put in nitrate removal plant. Is it low enough that we can blend? And it is, I just got these last results this afternoon, so I didn't figure on them. But the first results were if we wanted to blend, put a well up here to blend with the east well, which is your highest at 11. It was going to have to be almost an 1,100 gallon minute well to bring that well down to 7 on nitrate, which is 7 is my target. That's a big well. You're not going to get that. Okay, so then the next thing we look at is, okay, can we pinch this well down? And yeah, we can do that. And then we can start blending. Well, then how long is it going to last? And, you know, I saw that happen to Bell Creek. There's lasted 10 years before it went over the limit. And even before then, they couldn't blend any because the blend was over. So, if you wanted to just put in a blending, you could probably save $1.5 million off of what we're doing putting in a treatment plant. But here's the other half of it, is that right now, you're going to get a 30% loan forgiveness on a plant if you put it in now. Let's say you're just going to blend. 10 years from now, you're over the limit and you're having to put a plant in. Well, the plant's going to cost two or three times then what it is now. You don't have the loan 30% loan forgiveness. So that plant 10 years from now, 5-10 years from now, is going to cost you a whole lot more than it is now. And these are just things to think about. Until we get some of the results, you know, when Nate gets done with these test wells and we find out some more things, we'll know more about where we are. But
okay, I have a question. If we decide with this last well that we tested, the deeper one, if we say, okay, we're gonna put a nitrate plant in. That's what we're gonna do. We like the nitrates here, we're going to put the nitrate plant. Do we have to do the other test wells?
No, you don't have to do the test wells at all. What they're going to do is just give you more information that you'll have a better idea, hopefully, that in 3 years we're going to be in trouble or, we're not drawing anything down out of that top aquifer. It could be quite a while before we have a problem. Or if you, you know, you drill it, you, you know, you find out from your test well, and it's sucking down out of that top aquifer fast, then you know you have no choice but to put in a treatment plant. Now, that's what this is going to do, is just give you more information to make a decision on.
And the only reason you're looking at a well here is to replace that one.
Right.
But if you put in a treatment plant, and you're gonna bring the water to it, do you necessarily have to have a production well there?
And that's true. You do not.
Well, the other benefit of moving, getting that well over there for basically the same dollars was eliminate that for money, and we have the ground there already for everything.
Right. And you don't have to go under railroad tracks.
And we got this ground out here being wasted.
Yeah. And that's the thing that you can do, is we could just go ahead and put a well in out here and put a treatment plant in and go. Mm-hmm. And yeah, you don't know some of the things, but it's not going to kill you if you don't know.
What's the additional net? What's the additional cost from right now through the test you're talking about? Your services, everything. What's the additional cost?
You'll spend $10,000 pretty easily by the time we get those drilled. And
we've already spent what?
You're charging too much then.
We've already spent almost $10,000 on drilling right now, right?
I don't know. I don't know what parts has bid has. I've got 5-6 days.
Understood. I don't know
what they've got. I don't know what they're running. But you're talking about renting a generator, a pump. You're talking about 1 to 2 days of drilling, a day of development, and a step test, and then a 24-hour test. Yeah, you'll spend $10,000 pretty easy.
Plus your time.
Well, that would include some of my time as well. Then we'll have some sampling costs.
We're spinning our wheels to find out something we already know.
Yeah, I got a question. This 1.3 nitrate number, as hard as our irrigators are pumping today, that could be very false, couldn't it?
I don't have a problem with that.
That's only going to last another 2 months.
Yes, exactly. You don't know.
We don't know.
But and it's 1.3 now. That's the thing that's, and that's the reason I've recommended going 200 feet northwest. Again, is this an anomaly, or is this representative of that deeper zone? You know, before we found that, one of the things we looked at was that 24 an anomaly, or was that representative of the upper zone? But what I think we have found out from the testing of the domestic wells around is that it's not necessarily an anomaly, but it is associated with that field. And what we have upgraded is better than what is at the field. So if we get off 200 feet to the northwest and we're back up into that 5-6 range, then that's an indication that we've got something getting damp over here for some reason or another. But we're not here. That 1.3 actually is anything under 2 we consider background, naturally occurring.
Yeah, I'd like. Well, wouldn't you typically say with as much water as we're pulling through the aquifers right now, that number should be higher?
Yeah. Should be higher. The
water if we have a.
You think what?
The water's running backwards. Seriously. I'm serious. Good water's coming
in. I ain't arguing with you.
But if we go ahead and decide to just go with this deeper well here and go forward without drilling anything else, it's just information that we are not going to have.
Exactly. Right. Yes. What Neil does is he's going to give you...
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So how much, I mean...
And that's a decision that you have to make.
Yeah.
You know, it's how much information do you want to have to make your decision?
$3 million.
Yeah, you're talking a $3 million project right now. I mean, that's because I've run the numbers using full wells, and it's right at $3 million.
And if they do it over here, do they have to do 4 wells?
No. You do not. No. Now that's another one of the options that I have thought about.
If we're going to do it down there, and it's higher down there than it is here.
But the reason we're talk about doing four wells is you do four smaller capacity wells so that it's not as likely to pull the nitrates down. You know, if you put one bigger well in, you have a larger chance of pulling the nitrates down, too. But if you put smaller wells in, you know, and one of the things that I've thought of is that, okay, we start, you don't need the water. I mean, you have enough capacity in your wells now to survive. Is that if you want to, you start out with one smaller one, a 200-gallon metal well or whatever. Put your treatment plant in there, and then at some point in time later on, all you're looking at doing, if you say, oh, we need another well, all you have to do is put another well in. You're not looking at putting a whole treatment plant in on your own.
But that wouldn't be any trouble of asking to put another well down.
No, as long as we have the water rights, and what we'll do is we'll set this up as a battery now so that if you wanted to.
But if we do not certify a battery, they'll roll back to one well.
Okay.
And then you'll have to reapply for a battery.
Yeah.
But yeah. we can certify it.
One what?
One well, okay.
Yeah, they will only certify or no, once you notice and prove, send in notice and proof to the state that we have our system in.
Yes.
They're going to come out and say, okay, you only put in one well instead of a battery well. So they'll automatically roll that permit back to a single well.
Well, right.
And then if you decide you want a battery down the road, you'll have to reapply.
And would that be a problem? Should be.
You know, that's one of those deals that I think we can get a battery without any trouble now.
But who knows?
Who knows?
Who knows?
Yeah, and that's where you already have the water rights for here, and we're staying within the half mile to the east mile. In theory, it should not be a problem. But water rights, everything with water is changing very quickly because there's going to be a time when good water is going to be more valuable than oil.
So it would make sense to go ahead and drill this one where the good one is, and then move forward or move which direction you say?
Northwest.
To the northwest and put one more down.
One more 2-inch, yes, to bedrock. And that would be very similar to...
I don't think you guys are talking the same ballgame here.
Okay. Where I'm leading to is if we decided to certify it, if we wanted to do two wells, get them certified.
Yes.
If we didn't need this one.
Yes, if we wanted to put two wells in now.
If we want to put two wells in now and certify them and not use this one.
Well,
no, you're going to use it.
Yeah,
you would have to use it. You would have to use it, or you will
lose it.
It's called partial damage.
Yes.
I mean, if you're going to drill it, we just will tie it in and use it.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, and that would be, two would be the start of your battery.
Yes.
And you put your 300-foot circle in, and you figure all that out, and we make that work. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
But then we can add later.
If you felt like you needed to. Then you could put the third and fourth well in. At least the way things are right now, you could.
Yeah. And on the second well, you could possibly just use your minimum.
Probably.
Yeah. Am I talking is it kind of like the same thing as the irrigation on a farm?
No.
Will it have a minimum then?
Well, it will be tied in with the rest of the water rights. And the way a battery system works is you can have up to four wells within a 600-foot diameter circle, no more than 200 gallons a minute. Okay. What they would do is they would assign a rate and quantity to each well, whatever we end up proving out for those wells. So if the testing tells us that the first well will do 100 gallons a minute without any trouble, and the second will do 125, and that's what we meter and prove out, then that's what they will certify those wells at eventually.
Okay.
That's what they will approve. So then they will also tie that back into the quantity used in the total right with the additional well to the south. That gives you the flexibility of splitting that total usage up now between three wells instead of two. These wells will be, assuming they're smaller capacity wells, which I would recommend at this time, is you can still get a lot of water out of them. You're just going to pump them more. They'll be smaller capacity wells. Instead of 500 gallon a minute or 100 gallon a minute, they pump five times longer. In extreme summers like this, that may be an issue. In extreme summers, the additional storage that you're looking at putting in will help offset that. But in normal years, it wouldn't necessarily be that big of a problem for you because you have all the other capacity.
Yeah, you have the other route.
Yes.
Okay. So would it be unreasonable to stay down the path with Dawn towards the nitrate plant and test these three wells again on October 1st?
Do that.
I would say if you're really looking at putting in two wells now, that if we pick out where the second well is going to be and drill a test hole there, you want a test hole pretty close to where you're going to have your second well.
Yeah, that's why. Yeah. That's the good drill mark.
Well, I mean, this one's already there. You know, I mean, we know.
That's what I mean. I mean, drill the 100 gallon minute well right there.
No.
Can't buy that.
No.
How big?
No. Not 800. Not 700.
No.
No, because you only have 15 foot, you won't have any more than 15 foot screen in that well. Yeah. And the reason for that is if we put in two larger capacity well at that location, our cone of depression will reach up and we're gonna pull that top water in.
So if you're gonna use a new well there, how many gallons?
Yeah, I don't have that information. That's what the test well will help us determine, is what that pumping rod is. The 5-inch test well will help determine the capacity of the production.
That's big.
And if you're looking at putting in a battery, then it's going to be limited to 200 gallon anyway.
Yeah, but you're not going to get 200 more 200 gallon a minute we can't exceed 800 gallon a minute on a full well battery. If for some reason the data suggests that we can get 250 gallons a minute, that would be something we would have to ask DWR or whoever, for the most part. Not that they won't do that, we will have to justify it. So. But a large capacity well, like what you normally run for the city, will not do what you want to do. It will create problems down the road. That's my opinion. And
wouldn't your opinion going to be that it's going to increase over time anyway?
No.
The nitrate.
We have a system in place on another city that it's not doing that. The geology is slightly different, but not entirely different. But we did limit their pumping rate on the new road. And we basically cut them almost 100 gallons a minute. So instead of 490, they're pumping 400. And there was a reason for that.
My guess would be I agree with you, based on what I've seen. I think it's rare what Ned is saying.
Yes.
I do too.
That they don't increase over time.
Otherwise, every well in this country has a tendency to just continue to climb.
I mean, well, right, and part of that's because of construction.
Well, I'm not saying that, but I'm just saying
odds are.
Just because we have one well that's right, don't mean we're going to save our little neck of the woods when there's 50,000 wells around here today.
That's the reason it needs to be determined if that is the anomaly, if that's the route the city wants to take.
I don't think a 24-hour test you can pull enough water to know that. When you're going to be pulling for years out of one well or two wells out of that zone, you're still going to be pulling. It's true. And in years like this where we got our irrigators pulling all directions either, that's changing the flow underneath. And then we're going to start pulling. I think trying to go about this without putting a nitrate plant is a waste of money.
I agree with you.
Now, how to go about getting that well is another deal, but I think, to me, going into this theory thinking that we can blend is a joke. I think it's a delaying process.
I agree with that, too. But I don't want you to think that I'm trying to sell you something.
No.
Because I know that there's going to be somebody look at this and say, you got a well that's less than two, why don't you blend? I know there's going to be somebody say that.
We will have any maintenance costs until we have a problem.
Yeah.
That's right. And if you turns out that that you only need that plant 10% of the time, boy, your operating costs are way down.
Right, but I'm just saying to go into this with the theory that we can get by without a nitrate plant to me is,
yeah.
I mean, that's just blowing smoke because it's going to happen.
That's a very likely possibility, and that's one of the things we discussed from the get-go. You were right. Downstream of town.
Well, that's what I'm trying to figure out, whether we this extra $10,000 or $15,000 for additional testing is really worth it. When the end result is probably going to be the same thing, we're going to put a nitrate plant in.
It just depends on whether you want a well at that location or not.
It'll give you more information on the well is what it's going to give you. I don't think it's going to change your opinion on whether you want to plant it.
If you don't have to have a well at that location for your nitrate plant, then we're done. And put the nitrate plant in and
but if we don't have a well there, we're not putting a nitrate plant there.
All your land for
the they were recommending having a well at the nitrate plant. That way, if you had a backup generator or whatever,
yes, I really like
that. Well, would have power, so you would have water.
Right. Yes,
which I totally agree with.
Yeah. The land's there for your settling kids.
Yes.
But if we go ahead and just drill the second hole along with the steeper one, we still don't need to do testing, do we?
I don't understand your question.
Well, if we drill another well, it's going to cost us, and do the testing, it's going to cost us $10,000. Am I correct?
A test well, yes.
Yes, on a test well. Okay. Now, if we don't want to do all the, can we just drill a well without testing?
Sure. Would not recommend that.
Yeah, I don't
would not recommend that at all. And the reason for that is, as we discussed the other night, is we are downstream of town. We are downstream of former machinery shops.
Yes.
The test well, the other thing that does is that allows us to pull all the state samples, which would be the heavy metals, the volatile organic compounds, the synthetic organic compounds, the whole works. Radiologicals, you will not pass radon. The proposed rate on that is going to be out there. The other radiologicals, I do not anticipate that being a problem in this area. It's going to be the VOCs. That would be the next threat. The solvents, gas, diesel.
The reason I would think you need a test well is sometimes formations change. And I've seen this happen in a couple hundred feet. You can have a good well here, and a couple hundred feet away, you have nothing. And so before we get too far down the road, I think we would want to know where that other well is going to be, what you're going to have.
Is that 10,000 figured into your 3 million?
I'll tell you what I've done is I've redone just about a month ago. We opened bids on a plant smaller than this, but very similar. And I updated my costs and some of the things have gone up. And I put my costs in where I really think if you did it today, what your cost would be. But then I added 10% just because I'm figuring it close, okay? So we can take that out of the 10%. That's what I would. Okay, just so you know where I'm at. So, yeah, we could include it. Yeah, and that's something that, if you get to that point, if you want to include this as part of your loan from KDHE, they will allow you to do that. Now, you keep track of, you know, I'm sure you've already got your water account over here, or nitrate account. You keep track of all this, and then when we get done, we can roll it in.
Okay, counsel. So we are moving forward with the nitrate plant. Am I correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Come on.
So, nitrate plant up here, am I correct?
Do you have any questions at all? Like I said, you know, by doing this, by putting in two wells, we're going to be more than we would be tying that well down there.
Right.
Now, I agree. My recommendation would be to do this. I don't like that well down there, but it's your money. I'm not trying to get you to spend more money.
Well, I would think it'd be a good reason to get rid of that one just because of some other issues, too.
Exactly.
Right.
Yes.
That it's going to be coming down the pike at some point.
Yes, I do, too. Now, I would keep that well down there on an emergency basis.
Right.
You know, you've got it. Don't give it up.
No, right. That's right.
You know, keep
that's
it.
That's right.
But it's an emergency well. And DWR will let you do that.
And test the other hole or no?
Are you working? Well, I got it. So you heard that. About $10,000 to drill another 5-inch well?
Yes.
And monitor it for 24 hours?
A 5-inch well or you said?
Well, a 5-inch well and a
2-inch
yes. Observation well to the northwest. Which would be very near and another potential well site. The other thing that does is that it gives us a spread on the base of that aquifer to look at water quality as well.
For that 5-inch casing and the 9-inch borehole we were talking about earlier, that's about $3,000.
That's going to be a little bit more now.
You think so?
And because we're talking about, you'll also then have a bill from KDHE for all the state things. And I don't know what they're getting for those, Don. You know now.
No, I don't.
I'm sure.
The nitrate only, I think, is 40 gallons.
Yeah, but I mean,
the whole
state,
thing is, I'm not
state
sure.
Test, it'll be $1,000.
I kind of think we have all the answers we need to move forward with the treatment plan. That's how I feel. I don't want to do any more testing, but.
He's already got figured in bringing two wells to that site.
My $3 million has four wells.
Right.
Yeah. So if you want to go two wells, you know that a well is a little less than $100,000 each. And that's, I mean, we just opened bids on a well, and it was $99,000. Now Clark has told me if we did four of them here, they'd probably charge a little less, but.
I don't think
we want
to go that route.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just my opinion.
So. Like I said, you can do one and see what happens, or you can do two and see what happens. It's, you know, like I say, if you do one, it's going to be qualified as a 1-1. If you do two, then you've got a start on the battery so that later on, if you ever needed to, you could possibly add two more wells. And if you do two of them, you can do a little smaller wells and get by, have less chance of pulling the top water down. Now, if you don't want to do the 5-inch test hole, I can understand that, but I really think that if you're going to do a second well, you got to do a test hole with a second. You got to know what's there.
Right, I understand that, but I think.
Yeah.
The rest of it, I mean, we're just. I don't know.
And that's fine.
I might be wrong totally in my thinking. I don't know. We just keep going dollar and dollar to just make it better.
Hey, do you want to do one well or two wells?
On your plant?
Yeah, that's the plant.
You need at least two so you can blend. That's a no-brainer, isn't it?
I'm not sure.
No, they're not that
for you. You want to blend that same well in part of it and treat part of it.
The blending process is to blend these wells with your other wells that are high in nitrates.
Right.
And so the more water you have that's low in nitrates, the more you can blend with a well that's high. So if you only have a 200-gallon mineral well, you're going to have to treat more of your high well. Mm-hmm. But if you have two 200-gallon wells, then you're going to be able to blend more and treat less. So,
well, I think we ought to go ahead and drill the other well and get it tested. And that way we have to start with the battery. We'll just not do all the, not drill the other test wells further on down until later.
That's what I was trying to.
Drill your 5-inch.
I'm glad you said it for me. I was trying to.
Have you pump it?
And well, you're going to drill another one off to your whatever distance to the northwest that he was wanting to do. Drill that well. Run the test so we know exactly what we got, just like we did on the other one, and then stop with the drilling for a while.
Do only instead what's of doing
other, instead of doing other test yes. wells, just yeah. to be monitoring. You know.
Do two of them necessary for the plant so we can get started on the plant.
Sounds like a great motion.
Thank
awesome,
you.
I did.
Yeah, you did. Thanks, Troy. You took it, my words out of my mouth.
I think you need a second.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Wait a minute.
Troy, what's your motion?
That we go ahead with and drill the other well.
But we're not doing
and,
all the testing.
And test that well.
Yeah.
But we're not so drilling, not to drill any more test wells further on down across or whatever.
We're
going to
approve Park Well Service to drill a 5-inch test well. Is that what we're
is
saying?
Is that right?
You've got me confused because now you're talking about drilling the test well, the 5-inch test well.
No, I'm just saying go ahead and drill the other well for the second one of the battery.
Drill the additional 2-inch test hole, yes. 200 feet in.
Yeah, that's what I think.
Is that what you're wanting done?
If that's a good recommendation.
Yeah, the 2-inch.
Yeah, that's just for monitoring well.
That's correct.
But you will know if
but
you've got.
Yeah, you'll know what you've got.
Yes, you'll know if you're in sand, you won't know the capacity of it.
Well, I was going to say, we won't. I mean, if we drill this at the 5-inch or whatever it is that the well would be, and do the testing compared to drilling a 2-inch and then going and drilling another one, wouldn't
we use that observation well offset from the 5-inch test well as far as getting information for aquifer characteristics. That is a key component of finding out exactly what impact those test wells have on the aquifer.
But you can still, cannot still get that same kind of information on a 5-inch compared to a 2-inch?
We use the two well system because the impact of the aquifer at the well site itself will be different than the impact in the aquifer at the observation well. And it is the combination of the data from those two wells that we build the database for developing aquifer characteristics.
So unless we go with one well, there's no way we can do without spending another $10,000. If we want to start a battery, we're going to spend another $10,000.
You're going to spend $10,000 if you want to put in one well, because we have to have the 5-inch test well at the existing well site to get all the state samples. Let me back up. We can drill a production well at that location and call it a test well. But if the data comes back that you have volatile organic compound contamination from upstream, then you have spent $100,000 on a production that you cannot use. Because the production well would have to meet all the state specifications. It's going to have to go through all the drawings. It's going to have to meet all of the grouting requirements. And they're going to look at that. They, quite frankly, I don't know the KDHE would approve it without a test well.
Okay, let me ask this then.
Go ahead, I'm
going to try. What are you going to do? Okay, I think we're just all wanting to know, what do we need to do to get our water plant started?
Build a plant and pipe the wells.
We decided we want to go with two wells.
We don't have to do any more reforming.
And so our next step, in order to go toward just those two wells, would be what?
Testing.
Yes.
Now, one thing to get...
Like Ned was talking about us doing at the very beginning.
That's a different... Jackie, I think that's a different... And what you're asking is, what do we do to get the treatment plant in? You pipe two, don't.
Maybe what I'm asking.
You pipe in two wells to that location and put the treatment plant in. And you don't put any production wells in. That's what gets your treatment plant up there.
I just, the minimum amount of drilling we have to do to get to the plant.
Right now, you
want to have a production well at the plant.
Yes, we want a production well at the plant.
So, what's the minimum amount of drilling we have to do to do that?
What did you say, Kevin?
We have to drill the test wells. We have to drill
the well. One thing,
if we choose one well, the testing that we've done already, right now, would that suffice? If we go in there and drill one big well?
Yes.
That's against your recommendation. But what I'm saying, if we went in and did one production well, right where we're at, is that all the testing we would have to do and then get certified with what we've already done?
You can take that gamble. That is an option for the city. We would have to backtrack into the approval process through KDHE, because if we went to KDHE right up front to put in a production well at this location without a test well sample spraying,
but we already
done
it.
No. This is very limited. This is preliminary testing. Wow. This is nitrates and salts only, Troy. Basically,
okay.
The test. We're going to fill 11 jugs. We're going to fill two radiological jugs. We're going to fill four pesticides, herbicide jugs. We're going to fill an inorganic analysis, very similar to what we have there. And we're going to fill a heavy metals. And we're going to fill an acidified sample.
But we can't do that out of the three holes that we've got drilled right now. We can't get that testing done where we could put one production well down right now if we wanted to do just one. Instead of going through and spending another deal to drill three more holes that we can't do nothing with.
Yeah, why didn't we get all that information from this right here that we need? I mean, that you were saying that we need from KDH, your KDHD ones. Why didn't we get all that information right then?
Because we just
wanted to know how much nitrates was there?
Part of the problem was nitrates, and the other problem is salt. The other problem we have is what's coming off the tank, or not coming off the tank, or coming off of the field. If the nitrates in that deeper zone were elevated or high, then you're essentially done.
Right, we'd be done.
Right. But now we have information that tells us that we have a zone at the bottom of the aquifer which has the potential to yield low nitrate water.
Right.
Now, how good is that? That water's been going through there for a long time and it's only 1.3. Is that what happens with induced pumping? I cannot answer that.
Well, I don't know your job, but to me, why didn't we just drill this one deep well, which is where you would suspect you'd find your lowest amount of nitrate?
Not necessarily.
Well, you would suspect, but why wouldn't, I mean, I don't guess.
Because we still use
a lot of money that I think we're not getting nothing
We
for.
Still use those wells in conjunction with the test well to determine the effects of that well on the aquifer.
But what good does that do us?
If that test well, if we put that test well in and we see a significant impact on the water level in that shallow observation well, then that tells us we have very good hydraulic connection between the upper zone and the shallow zone, or the deeper zone, and that the likelihood of that becoming contaminated is there.
Ned, could we pull a sample from that deep well now? and send it in and have the full analysis run on it.
Thank you. That's what I was trying to ask. Why we didn't do that? Why we
well, why would you pay for it if we didn't know if the nitrates weren't low?
Now that we know the nitrates are low,
yes. And timeliness. We were wanting to have some kind of an idea so we could come tonight and talk to you.
It was just Friday. They just did that.
Just did this Friday, yeah. Yes. And, yeah. And this is a hurry up. And get when you do the hurry up, you get the limited edition.
Okay.
Yes. Now, but what can we go ahead and pull a sample from that deep well and have a full-blown analysis run on it? Now, it's not going to tell you the capacity or anything like that, but it'll tell you if it's a good enough well.
At the pumping rate that we would get, we would be doing good if we could get 2 gallon a minute, because we're going to have to use a 12 volt submersible on that well. We will not be able to airlift that to get that sample. Even though we can airlift at 30 gallons a minute, we cannot use the airlift method to collect those samples. The airlift method, where we put air down the well, blows water out the top. So we have to use a submersible pump to collect that information.
Do they have one going to it?
Yes. Yes. Fletcher, I don't know that ADHE will look at that, very suspect.
What's the minimum?
This is no different than going out and having somebody bring you a soil sample from somewhere in the field.
This is his.
And then design a whole nutrient management plan for that field. That's the reason we put in these additional wells, is so we not only look at the vertical stratification of that aquifer, but we looked out a way with the domestic wells to look at the aerial extent across that aquifer. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense, but I still don't understand why we can't use, whether it's your idea or our idea, why we can't use that well to figure out whether we have sufficient, the quality's good enough to get us to be where we can put one certified well down if we wanted to, and without drilling any more wells. What's so different about this hole than some other hole you're going to drill over here and come up with that?
Pumping capacity. Pumping capacity is the difference.
What did you just say earlier? You didn't think we could get 2 gallons? What was that?
Yeah, we're only going to get about 2 gallons a minute out of that deep well with the centrifugal pumps that they have available for that. Maybe 5 if we bring in a ground cost. That's going to add to the cost to do that. I mean, it's a function of equipment.
It's a function of a dollar.
Exactly. It's not cheap to do. This is not a cheap process, and that's the reason I was very upfront. If putting in a treatment plant is what is most cost effective for the city to do, and that's what they want to do, then by all means do that, and we can stop the testing costs.
1 well or 2 wells at the site? Don, I'm asking you.
I'll put 2.
Okay.
Can we just say we'll go toward that and do the minimum, whatever we need to do to get there? The minimum cost. I know you're not happy with all the rest of the costs going into it.
Well, I think in the scheme of things, when you're looking at a water treatment plant, $10,000 is a drop in the bucket, if that's what we need to spend to get us there.
Well, we've already spent 10, now we're talking 20, and then we're talking 30.
10 more.
You add 100 pennies together, it's still going to live it all.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
But to get to where we're going, that's what we have to
do. It just gives you more information to make your decisions.
And that's what they're basically recommending we do. And you're the educator.
That's what I do.
The experts, and I don't know enough about it to not agree with you, although I was disagreeing 10 minutes ago. Now I think I understand it all.
This is a very unique situation in the fact that we have some potentially good water.
Well, if we overpump it, we're going to cause problems. The goal is to get as much water out of that aquifer, that portion of the aquifer that we can get without overpumping it and not dragging in anything else. The other thing that we have to look at is what's going on up gradient of that well. Now, when I say up gradient, we in this area, we look at travel times in the aquifer here of a foot to a foot and a half per day. So how long was the St. John dealership there? How long was that? How long was that there?
Late 80s.
So every year, the potential.
When did it close?
That would be a potential contamination site. I'm not knocking shingles. I'm not saying it is. I'm not saying it isn't. But that is a potential site. So every year, we have water potentially moving 365 feet minimum downstream of that site. So, and that could be a long-term problem.
Someone would like to make a motion to...
We actually have a motion.
Yeah, we need to...
You pull my motion back from
that. You want to withdraw your motion?
Yeah, you can draw one back.
Should be drilled 5-inch diameter.
So then change, then, okay, so the motion fell, so
that's our lesson learned on these three wells. If they would have been 5-inch, you could have hard pumped them and be done.
But you would have spent a lot of extra money on a 2-inch shallow intermediate.
$2-$3 a foot in casing. I'll second that.
Second my motion?
Yep. It's the only one on the table.
Any more discussion?
What was the motion again?
To drill the two test wells, one 5-inch and one 2-inch, to move towards the nitrate removal plant.
Okay, the two wells we're going to drill are the ones northwest of what we've already done, correct?
No. The 5-inch test well will be at the cluster of the 3-inch observation wells that are over there. We will be right next to the shallow observation well with the 5-inch test well, because that will be one of the production well sites, potentially. The one to the northwest would be a 2-inch observation well to monitor what impacts the 5-inch production well has on the aquifer at that distance, if any, as well as
get us formation samples and a water quality sample to look at that portion of the aquifer in relationship to where we're drilling.
So where would our second production well go? They'd have to drill yet.
That would potentially go to the northwest. That would be the direction that we would line that battery of wells.
What's the price difference between drilling that a 2-inch and a 5-inch? Just like they're like he just said, make it a 5-inch instead of a 2-inch.
But we still need the 2-inch observation well to monitor the effects of the production well or the test well on the aquifer.
We can't use that 5-inch well?
Yes, we will use that 5-inch well, but the quality of the data goes down dramatically because you're now looking at a single point in the aquifer that you're looking at. We have to look at the efficiency of that well. But if we have a piezometer in the aquifer or an observation well in the aquifer, then we look at the direct impact on the aquifer from the pumping well.
Any more discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed say no.
Thank you for being patient with us.
No, you cannot talk now.
Read the word into that deal.
No, I don't get it.
Basically, 1-5-1.
Well, no, I'm going to read the motion again. I mean, I know it's bad. We're going to drill two wells?
One and two.
Mm-hmm. Well, so I've drilled another five.
We've got to drill another five, no matter what.
Maybe. Five depends on what we find.
Okay.
Come
on.
Okay.
Yes.
Part of THE's time frame on this. I sent this to John last week and make sure that we all know where we're going here. Last week he said 2 weeks they were going to get the application out. Well, I went ahead and printed it off of the internet, gave it to John, and so we can get started. But one of the things that we have to do is the environmental report. There's like 10 or 15 agencies that have to comment on it. The first thing before we can even start on that is that we have to identify where we're doing things, okay? And so are we for sure agreed that we're putting the treatment plant out here, the ponds at the north end of the property, and that we're running the lines through town the way we've talked about? Because I will make up a drawing for that, run it by mail, and then we can get started on it. Now, hopefully, there's no Indian that cares. The Indians have veto power wherever it is. A couple of years ago, there was an Indian that decided they were going to, and they made us do cultural surveys on every water line I did. Now, that guy's no longer there, and next chief, whatever, doesn't care. But everybody has to comment on this environmental thing. And so if we're all in agreement on what we're doing, I'll get started on that so we can start on the environmental, because that's what takes the longest. KDHE estimates that it will take 2 months for us to get the environmentals and all that stuff done. Then they have up to 3 months after that for their review and to get it going. So we're talking 5 months before you get money from KDHE, okay? So that's a minimum of what we're looking at.
So basically you're saying you don't want anyone at this table to throw a glitch in it.
That's right.
Kevin.
We're here. I don't care who.
Just
we have decided this is what we're doing. And so once I get, it's still possible to change, but I don't want to change once we decide, once we make our decision. This is what we're going to do. And so.
Once we get a forgiven loan, it's X anyway.
Now, they've lowered the interest rates It's 2.81% right now. And so, yeah.
I don't think we can afford to postpone it.
See, this is as good a deal as you're ever going to get.
Okay, run with it.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay, so the plan's going out here. Answer his question. The plan is going out here, draw it up.
Yes.
Council?
Yes.
Yeah, after 20,000, now it's go that way. So.
Okay.
Okay.
Now, I'm going to send you bills as I go along. If you have money to pay them, that's fine. If you don't, I will wait until until you get the KDHE money.
Is it a guarantee that we're going to get this money?
Yes, that's what he told me this afternoon. Because you are on two things. You are on the intended use plan. You've been there for a while. And you are a quality violation. You have...
quality violation.
Yeah, you know, you have nitrates over the limit. I have another town that has been hounding me to get money, but they're not on that violation list, and so they cannot get 30%.
I don't feel comfortable not paying you until we get the money, though.
Well, I mean, that's up to you. Now, some towns have the money that they pay us. Now, I don't want to run you short.
Okay.
You know, this is going
to
be entirely...
We have a budget. We have to be...
Exactly. Yeah, you know, so I don't want to run you out of your budget. If you have money to pay me, that's great. That makes me real happy. But if you don't, I understand, and that's part of the game. So.
We'll see what we can do.
But like I said, it's going to be... Most likely 5 months before you see KDHE funds.
I understand that there was a $6 fee put on about 20 years ago. It was to go to the against any repairs on the water. Is that true, John?
Well, that's the CIP, the capital improvement water. Yeah.
Well, there should be plenty of money to pay him if we have to repay.
And John Haas has said he's done the rate study. Have you gotten it?
That is true, but that wasn't going to be at this table tonight.
Okay, that's fine. And he didn't share with me, so I don't know what it is.
He said that Rosemary would do our application to grant there. So.
Yeah, they're going to help us on the application. So. Okay.
Okay.
That's all I have. If you have any questions, give me a call.
Okay. Thanks, Don.
Thank you.
Thanks for waiting so long.
Yes.
Thanks, Ned.
Sure.
Thanks, Mike. Glad you showed up again, Mike.
Hey, it was great to see you guys.
That was pretty good. Okay. Thank you, guys. Be careful going up. Okay, just a minute. Yes. Yes.
Do you need me for anything else in the agenda about my answer?
I don't know, that's not me, that's Mel. Mel, does he need him for an executive session? No. Bobby? No. Okay, as far as I know, no. Okay, thank you. No, I appreciate it. Okay. Generation.
That's all of us a break and we're coming over here, won't it?
Okay. Number three, generation information.
Yeah, I just want to pass on some information as far as what will help the city when we have an outage when it's this hot. I mean, our circuits are really loaded. I mean, we have the capacity to generate, but it's best way to explain it is that when we start up the generators, when it's this hot, we have to run all three engines. And when we turn our circuits on, because of the load we have on there, it would be very helpful if people would, when we have an outage like this, is to turn our air conditioning off so that when we turn that circuit back on, we don't get hit with the maximum load that was on when the power went off. So when you can leave a light bulb on or you know, a light or a fan or something, so it comes back on, okay, they've got my circuit on, and, you know, if I say wait 3 minutes, everybody will turn it on in 3 minutes, we'll be right back where. So over the next 3 to 5 minutes, and like I say, how do you know who to do what? But if you can kind of spread it out, it would be very helpful to the plant down there when we do that. Also, when we have an outage like this, people continue to run their lawn sprinklers if they're not on a well. Of course, running a private well, you're adding loads, so if you can shut those off and turn off any outside sprinklers that you're using city water on, because it just doesn't take them only 50,000 gallons, and you can figure as high as how many sprinklers, and if it takes a while to get a circuit on where the well is, we've seen it get quite low. Those are just some things that would be very helpful when we have an outage. I know some people comment, well, it seems like it's taking an extra long time, but this is different than an early spring storm or an ice storm in the winter, because usually we can handle it with one unit and the circuits are not loaded that heavily, but this is a whole different volume. So if people can think along those lines, it would be very helpful. So.
And I asked Mel to do that, by the way, because getting phone calls left and right, how come we don't have electricity yet, how can we? Well, it takes a while to get them motors warmed up down there. It's just not a flip of the switch and here we go. It takes a while to get things to go and monitors looked at, stuff like that. So I just wanted the public to know that it just takes a while to get things going back up. Yeah, you're hot for a while, but hey, at least we have our own generators.
I mean, we all know it's an extreme situation.
Choose your time carefully.
Purchase of a dump truck.
Oh, your executive session.
I can do that first, or however you want to do it.
Doesn't matter, whichever.
Okay. Well, I've already mentioned it. We did find a dump truck with a snow plow and a spreader through the state. This part of transportation. I've had just my own this truck for a long time, and I knew it was going to be coming up. It's a 1996. It's a single axle.
We already heard about it. What's the price?
$14,000.
I move to approve the purchase of a new dump truck for $14,000.
From Kansas Park Transportation.
Kansas Park Transportation.
Is that air brakes?
Yes.
Yes. I'll second that.
Bobby seconded.
He needs to eat. He's getting lightheaded.
There's cookies over there. I told Terry he couldn't open it unless he was quiet.
I know. I couldn't figure out how to do it quietly.
You could open it. I'm just giving you a hard time. Okay. Any more discussion?
Nope.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
I was supposed to say no. Thank you.
Okay. I'd like a 10-minute executive session for non-elected personnel, including myself, mayor, council, and John.
I'll look for that.
All in favor say aye. All opposed say no. Moving back to order. Is there any motion?
I'll move to give Nick Knight a pay increase of 75 cents in the title of electrical supervisor. Probably still under some metal. And I'll evaluate in 1 year.
Say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no.
No.
Thank you. That's all I think I have.
Is there any question for Al Sweeney?
Touch with the science, but it's on new business.
Yeah, we'll put that in business. Okay. New business. Buffalo,
it was in your packets. Requesting that you waive the location, the distance requirement of 120-foot radius from a church or school.
How does that, property line given the door? How does that read?
That is the question that nobody seems to be able to answer. So when I talked to him and we discussed this, we both agreed that if we went through the waiver process, there wouldn't be any way for somebody to come back and say he didn't do it right. And he agreed that he wanted to do it right, so there wouldn't be any question or wouldn't be any problem with the city.
Well, I'll make a motion that we approve.
Second.
Yeah. Why wouldn't you use the sight line or the property line in the center of the street between two properties on each side and make it the center of the street? Why wouldn't you do that? Anytime you survey a piece of property, you come off the center of the street. If you're driving down a street, you have the option to look right, you have the option to look left, or you have the option to look straight ahead. Looks to me like the dividing line ought to be the center of the street, period.
Is we're just covering our butts. You know what I mean? We don't know what the actual, we can't answer where things are measured from or anything, but we're saying that no matter what, we're okay with this.
I understand what you're saying, Kathy. But what I'm saying is, why wouldn't you allow something on this side of the street, and you've got a church on this side of the street, why wouldn't you allow something like that? Use the center line of the street as the border line.
We can't determine that, even though we don't have any control over that, right? We don't know why.
So do you want to write something up different?
You say that's what we have to do,
to do what you're saying, we're going to have to write something up different.
That's what the zoning.
Your motion.
That's what I don't know. Yeah, is it zoning or is it
ordinance?
The motion is on the table.
Do you want to put that on new business? Let me take a look at that, figure out.
Yeah, I'd like to put that on new business and take a look at it.
Okay, wait a minute here. Time out. Here, we have a motion on the table, right?
Yes. For this particular situation, you're okay.
Okay, yeah, so this is a total different subject, right?
Well,
I thought the previous question, which means we have to stop discussion, I believe, and finish the motion.
The motion on the table is Troy moved and Jackie seconded to waive the distance requirements for the 120-foot radius from a church or school. For Pueblo Nuevo in their CMB application. Okay.
All those in
favor? Right.
All of you got it. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no. Thank you.
So, along those lines, can we at this point in time add to new business later on that Bobby asked just revisiting of the that thing. Is that the zoning thing? What the economy is talking about?
This is in our code.
Okay.
This is an ordinance.
Can we
change it? So you can change an ordinance?
Yes.
To do that.
On new business sometime. Next meeting, whatever. I am going to
hate that. You are worse than I should.
Kevin?
Okay. Now, the second thing was in our last packet was the Eden Valley Church request to use the east side of the square from 2 to 8 on August the 20th.
I'd like to motion to approve that too.
Second.
No more discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no. Okay. Bobby, 10-minute executive session.
I'd like a 10-minute executive session to counsel the mayor and elected personnel.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no. Parking sign. Who has that now?
This dated the 14th. We didn't get that in the office until today, so I'm glad we got it this time. She just called me up and said that she's had trouble with the letter says it all with people parking on the east side there. There is parking on Broadway in front of the business also, but she's addressed people about it. Anyway, so I said, you know, the best thing to do is
you only want the sign on 3rd Street.
Correct.
And those are already on the south side, aren't they, in front of the courthouse? You only have you have limited parking on the south side, but you don't on the north side of that.
There's some kind of parking
there. I thought
there was.
On the south side. The courthouse.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I can see where. That would be a frustration.
I don't think anyone even really knows that she's in this location.
Yeah.
So
wouldn't it help the courthouse too? I mean, still, it would still leave that on that other side of the street open for.
Yeah, I just really don't think too many employees park over there. I mean, most of them do use the parking lot.
If you have a court date, you're going to be in there more than an hour. You got to park half a block away. Can they park in your section across the street?
Is that employee parking only, or is it courthouse parking?
My section, as in
the county.
By the skate center?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's usually full of employee vehicles, and that could be why.
But then there's one on the other
it's
side.
Just more cost they will park in.
There's one, and we're going to start parking in back, too, as soon as the county opens that up for us. But
also on the south side of the courthouse.
Mm-hmm.
That's for public parking, too.
Yeah.
There is parking out on Broadway, you know, and parking right
there.
Oh,
that's true.
That's what I'm thinking.
Either way,
I don't see a problem either way, so.
I think we
give it some time. So if you look at old business, you want to table it?
Yeah, we can table that. Look at the.
Troy, Bobby, what do you guys think?
Table. Oh, second. Whatever we got to do.
We don't have a motion yet.
I'll make a motion on table.
Here we go.
Does somebody want a second then?
Second.
Mm-hmm. Any more discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no. I'm going to adjourn. I'd like to go ahead and take the Pride Committee off of business. I don't know what.
Nothing.
I just had a giggle. I'm sorry. I apologize.
And then I second to adjourn.
Do we have to have a motion to take that off?
And I want to donate a tree to me.
Okay. I'll do that next time.
I know. Next time, so that I have to.
I love your trees, yes.
Okay.
All in favor of.
Just a adjourn?
Yeah.
Say aye.
Aye.
Say no. We don't have enough.